Shall I start then? No? So yes, good morning. Okay, thanks. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for attending this talk. So, So as you can see in this example, you might not realize at first, but it is easier for readers to identify the original word metro when presented with the upper half of the word compared to the lower part of the word. The reason behind may be that in the Roman alphabet, the information at the level of letter features seems more distinctive in the upper part of letters than in the lower part. Sorry, so see for example here that the ambiguity is larger for the lower part of the letters compared to the upper part. However, the upper part advantage is obtained for words and not for isolated letter identification, as was found by Blaise and colleagues in 2009. Therefore, it is mainly related to the dynamics of the visual word recognition process. A few years ago, Perea and colleagues in 2012, excuse me, used the masked repetition priming technique to try to address the locus of this advantage. Note that in the masked priming technique, the prime is presented for less than 50 milliseconds, but it does affect the processing of the target while the participant is not aware of it. And this is a very safe way to measure bottom-up processing while avoiding strategic decisions from the participant. So Perea and colleagues found that the latencies for word targets like metro, a word like metro, were faster when preceded by either the upper part or the prime itself, compared to targets being preceded by their lower part. And what this shows is that the cognitive system is able to compensate for the missing information in the earlier stages of word processing. Or in other words, the upper part of words activate to a large extent their corresponding lexical units during the earlier stages of word processing in the absence of top-down conscious strategies. But note that, that the masked priming experiments measure recognition latencies of the same intact target preceded by a prime, here either the upper or the lower part. So we wonder, what about normal reading? What about isolated word identification? does the cognitive system compensate perceptual degradation to select the lexical match? Note that there is fMRI evidence on the increase of posterior parietal regions, on the increased activation of posterior parietal regions when reading words in a non-standard format. And this activity has been interpreted as a switch from an automatic word identification strategy to an attentional-based reading strategy. So here we tracked the electrophysiological signature of the upper part advantage in words for different, in words of different frequency. And this allowed us to assess the time course of the perceptual manipulation, upper versus full, and the time course of the lexical manipulation, such as word frequency. So the perceptual manipulation would impact the early stages of visual automatic processing, which are associated with the N170 component. In contrast, the word frequency manipulation was expected to impact later lexical semantic stages of processing, such as the P300. And this scenario would be consistent with a cascaded model of processing where a non-standard type of stimuli is rapidly normalized according to orthographic knowledge previous to lexical access. But another possibility was to obtain, an interaction between the perceptual and the lexical factors in the early stages of processing. Note that the experiments from Perea and colleagues showed that there was an early effect of, that the upper part advantage tapped early stages of processing. So we might expect that there could be an interaction between the perceptual and lexical factors in the early stages of processing. This would mean that the cognitive system compensates the visual ambiguity of the upper part of words with top-down lexical feedback via the attentional parietal pathway activation. So this second scenario would be more consistent with a fully interactive system that brings top-down feedback when perceptual ambiguity exceeds the capacity of the early detectors during visual word recognition. So this is the, I'm going to describe a little bit the experiment. It was a lexical decision ERP experiment where we included these two manipulations, the intact versus the degraded stimuli, which was the upper part of words and non-words, and word frequency, high versus low frequency words. We have to say that we only included stimuli with unambiguous letters in the upper or in their upper portion. So letters like I or J were not included. Some details about the experiment. There were 200 words and 200 pseudo words, and half of the words were of low frequency and the other of low frequency and high frequency. So we have 50 items per condition. The frequency of letters was equal across high and low frequency words. And it was a lexical decision task, so participants were expected to answer yes or no to the stimuli. If it was a real word in Spanish, they have to say yes. If it was not, they have to say no. So results for the behavioral results, there was a main effect of each of the factors that were included: frequency and degradation. So fastest latencies for the high frequency words compared to low frequency words, and fastest latencies for the full compared to the upper part of words. There was no interaction between these two factors. For the ERP results, we have the perceptual comparisons here, and you can see the shape of the waves for both the full and degraded condition. And it was very, very clear that the difference was started very early in the N170. And for the lexical frequency comparison, the effect started later, in a later time window. Importantly, there was no interaction according to the in the amplitude of these components, but there was an interaction in the latency of the emergence of the frequency effect, because it started a little bit earlier for the degraded condition compared to the full condition. So as a summary, the behavioral results showed a degradation effect, a main effect of degradation, a main effect of word frequency, which points to an additive pattern. And for the ERPs, there was a main effect of degradation and a main effect of word frequency. They didn't interact, and they occurred mainly in different different stages of word processing. So the conclusions, first, both behavioral and ERP results convert as they showed independent additive effects of perceptual and lexical manipulations. While there was an early effect of degradation in the N170, no early impact of word frequency was obtained in this state. So lexical information does not percolate into the earliest stages of processing. So our data favors the first scenario. The upper part of words are rapidly normalized in terms of orthographic knowledge. So the cost is observed in the early stages of processing, as shown by the early ERP effects, and also in the RT measures. And the earlier effects of word frequency in the degraded words than in the intact words may reflect the impact of attentional resources in the course of lexical decision, but not in the early encoded stages of processing. So that was all. I hope I make it as clear as possible, although I was speaking too fast. So if you have any question. Hello.
Thank you very much. Everything was clear. Yes, we have actually quite a time for questions since, yes, in the absence of one presentation, we can maybe loosen up a bit all the time limitations for this session. So we can allow a bit of discussion. Yes, Yuriy Shterov has a question. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much for the presentation. I have a more general question. What makes the upper half? I'm sorry if I missed it. What makes the upper half more salient? Is this attention, or is there something about letter shapes? Has anyone studied this? Whether more like parts of letters that are in the upper half are more informative, more distinct?
Yes. Originally, in the behavioral experiments, it is true that individual letters are more informative in the sense that there is less ambiguity for the perceptual detectors. Can I show you see here, yes, for example?
Yeah, I'm sorry if you said this and I missed it, but
I was talking too fast. But you can see here that the ambiguity increases for many words. And the ambiguity is larger for the lower part of the letters. You see that
the upper parts are more unique in that sense, and they allow for easier identification. Do you know if it has anything to do with attention? Like people tend to pay more attention to the upper halves, or is this something universal for other alphabets?
It's a great question, because it's something that it's not only maybe at the perceptual level, but also at the way that the alphabets were designed or the way they developed. Precisely. I don't know if it's occurring generally for all alphabets, that there are specific parts that which are more informative are in the upper part, and it's like showing that we are paying attention always to the upper part because it's normally more informative to the upper part of objects. It's something that we for sure had to analyze, because maybe this is just an example of perceptual, I don't know, design. But for here, I'm not sure what happens in the other alphabets, and we for sure have not compared this with the upper part of objects, but it would be a great step to see if this is something more general.
Right, thank you.
But I also have an idea which might sound a bit like a too distant association, but still, also about these potential more general mechanisms of visual recognition and reading in general. I just thought of that. You probably know this F reading eye movement pattern, which was described for reading web pages, which tells us that usually people scan through the page, so they sort of just read like top down on the left side, just skimming through the text, and then probably they just read maybe a top two or top three lines, then skip through another very substantial part, like a whole paragraph, and then read maybe something in the middle of the page. So it's also tends to gravitate towards the upper part, and this is of course completely different scale, because these results are for the whole page, the entire page. But what if this is just something more basic, that we are dealing with the upper parts of any text or any letters, or is this too general, such a like overgeneralization? What would you say?
Yeah, so you mean like, for example, that after reading many texts and after making an effort to capture the most important information, going fast, maybe we are trained to extract information from the upper part, and maybe that's what we are getting in this experiment. But that's a possibility. I'm really not sure right now if it can be disentangled in an easy way. Maybe it could be interesting to see what happens if you train participants to grasp information from the lower part, and maybe the results are similar, but I'm not so, but I think it's a combination of everything, that the letters themselves are informative, that we have managed to learn this, to optimize this information, and afterwards we can use it when we are reading isolated words. But I think I like the proposal that you have information in the upper part of objects, which are very informative, and maybe the alphabet has managed to optimize that tendency in, I don't know, for whatever reason, for cultural or biological reasons. Are we just exploding the two things, no? The training and the natural or the biological aspects from our vision? I'm not sure, but those are like big, very big questions.
Indeed. Thank you very much. And no, there is another commentary from Richard Shilcock in our chat. I'll just read it.
Okay.
I wonder if there is any role for dorsal versus ventral visual pathways. Goldstein and Babcock, 2001. I know the stimuli are small, but the upper lower cutoff in the retina is not sharp, but it might be worth looking at.
Can you read it again? Because I'm not looking, I cannot see the chat.
It's in the chat.
It's in the chat. Yes, definitely. I will read it again. So I wonder if there is any role for dorsal versus ventral visual pathways. And there is a link to the work of Goldstein and Babcock, 2001. I know the stimuli are small and the upper lower cutoff in the retina is not sharp, but it might be worth looking at.
Okay. Yeah. No, I understand. Yeah, that's a great proposal. I know from this differentiation between the ventral and the dorsal. So maybe that's a good way to think about these results in those terms. Yeah. Mm.